Dan Winter.
Thank you. You know, I thought maybe we'd try to synchronize our vibrations with doing what Noah suggests, which is doing a who together. We all take a deep breath, and then we think like that. So, deep breath. Thank you for that blessing. Thank you. And thanks for coming. You know, when we first met Danny Schreiber years ago, and I began to realize how brilliant he was in life force and biology and agriculture and his vision here. He has the center here and the one up in the hills. What's the other one called?
Cloud Temple Gardens.
Cloud Temple Gardens. And we actually made our first measurement of life force with Dan. So this year, when we came back to Australia, I said, we're going to do something fun with Dan. And here it is. I'm very... very grateful and pleased. And what a magic dream. So thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.
So today's conversation is going to be a bit of a science intro, but I'm working at ways of making the science intro lots of fun. That's the idea. So, I mean, the essential theme, the sort of radical breakthrough science we've been working at is to try to suggest that if you understand one simple symmetry, can I have the Star Mother, Valerie, for this? Yes. If you understand one simple symmetry, the shape that waves converge, you have a very precise model of the origin and cause of all centripetal forces. So this is, as you probably, most of you are familiar with the Star Mother, it's dodeca-icosa, which is, in my new equation, now precisely proven to be the geometry of hydrogen, and well known to the geometry of the DNA, every living protein, the geometry of the universe. And basically, palladium and most mysteries of physics have this symmetry one way or another. For example, E8 unified field thinking. So, if you understand one shape, so we don't allow anyone to say the lecture was complicated because we're only discussing one shape today. Okay? No one is allowed to go home and say, oh, that was too complicated for me. You're not allowed to say that, sorry. We're only discussing one shape. And that, if you understand that shape, and here's the animation of that shape. It's the stellation of the dodeca that creates this, we call it two pine cones kissing. And when two pine cones learn to kiss noses, it's called phase conjugation. And that geometry, as you can see, is related to the caduceus here. If we play the next image. You see that side view and the top view of the two golden spirals is the mystery of Hermes, the caduceus, but in physics that's called phase conjugation or perfect damping or implosive collapse. Now that's going to be the key to all these technologies, all kinds of cosmic stuff, healing water, energy from hydrogen, the nature of bliss, the nature of life force, the nature of alchemy. All of these mysteries are summarized in only one symmetry. So, the title of the lecture series that we have been delivering around the world for the last several years, including many conferences of physicists, actually. Nassim was with us in the first presentation of this in Budapest. That golden ratio perfected fractal phase conjugation, that shape, when waves make that pine cone shape, they conjugate their phases, like you have conjugal relations when you get married, for example. The DNA decides who is shareable. Are you a shareable wave? Yes. So that geometry is the electric cause and mechanism of all centripetal and self-organizing forces. All the mysteries of the universe. What is life? What is bliss? What is enlightenment? What is immortality? What is alchemy? What is implosion? What is fusion? What is a black hole? Every single mystery that we've all thought was a mystery in life, every single one, is summarized in that simple understanding of that precise symmetry, at the pure physics of what waves do, waves of charge, the ether, the plasma do, when they create that form. So that is the cause and mechanism and origin of gravity, life force, perception, bliss, enlightenment. It's the origin of alphabet. It's the physics of the origin of color. It is the very nature of fusion. It is the essence of alchemy, access to a black hole, all these great things. So, that sounds like a mildly ambitious science lecture, doesn't it? Now, the one way I've decided to try to make this fun, I mean, we could launch off now, and we will, and I will show you examples of how we apply that very specifically. We're going to start with applying that to how you understand human bliss, and then we're going to apply it to the understanding of compassion and of how DNA gets a soul, for example. We're going to look at the very nature of gravity and black holes and the physics of the reason that color exists, for example, and the nature of life force in general, all being this centripetal implosive force. But the way I've decided to try to make the science class particularly fun is to do the end of the talk first. Now, the way we've been telling this story around the world always is we sort of, people say, well, that's cool, you know, great, new physics, wonderful, but how do I apply it to my life? What does it mean to me? What does it mean to me and my kids today, et cetera, et cetera. And so the end of the lecture always is, well, the way you apply this to your life is you understand something very simple. You know how you can get a lot of books which are very thick about the reason for life, you know, the purpose of life. You know, if you're studying the purpose of life, you're probably going to have a lot of very thick books to read, right? Complicated subject, it would seem. Well, as a trained electrical engineer, I have a shortcut to present to you that could save you a lot of thick books. As an electrical engineer, my conclusion is that the purpose of life is to grow a large aura. Now let's investigate that idea. You see, essentially the way we conclude all of these lectures around the world, we say, well, in the end, you get immortal if your plasma, if your aura, is coherent. And so then there's the hygiene. And you already know the hygiene because you live in Byron Bay. The hygiene is you eat live food. You avoid monoculture and angry DNA. You need genetic diversity. And then you do the yoga. And then you live in a place where you have charged air and life force, avoiding metal in your buildings, where you can get what's called chi, prana, orgone, brahma, shakti, pot. These are all names for centripetal charge plasma breathing well. So the end of the conversations are usually, well, you know, do your homework, do the hygiene, eat live food, do the yoga, and live in a place of life force. And the fourth aspect of the hygiene has always been basically, you know how Jasmine teaches people how to live without food? She says, well, you need to walk barefoot in nature to absorb charge, and then you need to be doing something which you consider to be your highest level of service every day. And if you believe that, whatever it is, that will attract charge. So, you see, this little part of the exercise says that the reason electrical engineers can tell you clearly the purpose of life is to get a big aura is because, you know, some electrical engineers, for example, have studied the nature of death. And at death, what we've talked about this many times, most of you have seen this, that the plasma field that what you take with you when you die, which is very measurable, depends on how big or coherent is your aura. And the way you take it with you when you die, for example, we can measure the number of hours it takes it to leave your body. We know where it goes when you die. It goes down the songline dreaming track, and we know why, because that's very measurable magnetically, et cetera, et cetera. And what you see when you die, the sequence of visions, the map to successful death, lattice, cobweb, tunnel, spiral, that actually is simply the sequence of the braiding algorithms of DNA, and your DNA is preparing your plasma, your aura, your charge, to be braided sequentially and then compressed, imploded, and made projectable, which is to say, become a shareable wave, become well distributed. There's only one electron, it just gets around, so too for you, if you think a shareable thought. Yeah? So, this idea that it's obvious that the reason when scientists study the sequence of things you see when you die, the map to drive to Paris, I mean the map to die well, is simply the sequence by which your DNA is braiding, because that's preparing your plasma for implosive compression, charge distribution. So that's one good reason why you want to have a big aura, because getting immortal is a pretty good definition of. And what's defined as immortality is the coherent symmetry of charge memory, the emphasis being the word on the word memory, that you take with you when you die if you do it well. And so this develops an entire hygiene for successful death. You know, the Anunnaki did it at the altar at Machu Picchu because the electric field was fractal and distributable. The opposite, of course, is a hospital, which would be a very bad place to distribute your aura. So hence, you sort of read between the lines here what we're saying, is that you need a place, you make a magnetic map of your bed, and if it's a rose, you know, you got a shot at it, basically. And you need to be able to make a magnetic map of your bed, and that's called dowsing. And if you can't feel a magnetic line, you probably can't feel, truly. So the implication here is you should then, by this principle, be able to think about all of your major decision in life based on something very simple. Will my aura grow? Is it good for my aura? Like, well, I have a new boyfriend. Should I kiss him? I think that might be good for my aura. I'm going to try it, you know? All these complicated decisions you have in your life, basically. Or, you know, I'm ordering lunch, and here's French fries, and here's a salad. Now, let me think about my aura a few hours. Oh, you know? Or now I just arrived on the university campus, and I'm deciding where I'm going to sit. Shall I sit in a metal building or under an old tree? You see where this is going? Or Jesus says, somebody just touched me, I could feel it, and something happened to my aura. So essentially, the other thing you need to know is it's not selfish. It is not selfish to want to have a large aura. In fact, if you think a thought, which is called pure intention or a shareable thought or a generous thought, your aura actually grows. So, and the physics of that is something that we now teach. It's called a phase conjugate dielectric, which is physics language for what is in fact the electric field of the communion of saints, the collective unconscious. Physics knows a lot now about what that is. And it hasn't collapsed the romance or the mystery. It's made the romance and the mystery even more wonderful. Physics adds so much to spirituality and it puts so much love in it. It's a wonderful thing. It's not a phenomenological collapse. It's richness, actually. So here is physics discovering the nature of how your ancestral memory survives as an electric field. The technical term is a phase conjugate dielectric. It's a bioactive electric field. One example would be, if you read the extensive scientific research, if you plant a seed at Stonehenge, they grow measurably much faster. We've now discovered how to make that electric field. It's a bioactive electric field. It's called a phase conjugate dielectric, or simply fractalfield.com, a fractal field, our website, as it were. And so the paper on this in the electrical engineering literature, it's kind of fun, is called Allison barium titanate land, barium titanate being in phase conjugate dielectric or fractal field. Another example is the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant, acacia wood, the layers of gold. We'll show you later our actual modern day Ark of the Covenant, purify.com, P-Y-R-A-P-H-I, purify.com, you'll see the modern day Ark of the Covenant. And this is a centripetal, implosive electric field or fractal field. Which, like the Ark of the Covenant, and like focused human attention, will measurably cause electric fields to compress, will measurably reduce electrosmog, and will measurably reduce radioactivity. So I repeat, focused human attention and the Ark of the Covenant and a phase conjugate dielectric will do compress electric fields, reduce electrosmog, and reduce radioactivity. In fact, the Syrians who kind of built the Ark of the Covenant had their nukes, you know. That's what one of the original purposes. So if you understand what is a centripetal electric field, you understand life. Brings us to our next comment. Our good friend, Dr. Jerry Tennant, he's written this wonderful book. He's working with our technologies and biofeedback, and I'm consulting on his technology, the frequency signature of healing. And his book is called Healing.